Of course, they are one of the hottest rock bands, and with the release of R.E.M.'s new album, Monster, the rave reviews continue. In a rare TV interview, the band talks about their success, their staying power, and their new songs about love and lust. No, no, you bang,
bang, bang, bang, bang. A lot of records are cerebral, a lot of records are from the heart. This one's more from the crotch. Bang, bang.
You know, certainly you don't want to make a record like this when you're 45.
And now that we have the rock record out of the way, we can go on to that next phase that we're really looking forward to, the polka. You can see yourself now,
baby. They're known simply as R.E.M., four guys from Georgia who began rocking together in 1980 on college radio. That was just a dream. That's me in the corner. That's me in the spotlight. Today, 10 albums and countless awards later, they have become pop superstars, much to their own surprise.
None of us ever had set goals to become, like, you know, the hugest rock band in the world, or in the building, whatever.
Or in this room.
Or in this room. We were all avoiding school. None of us really wanted to be students, and we had kind of a Kerouac dream of traveling around the country in a van. Kind of seeing the country like Charles Carroll did.
Well, you guys have been together, what, over 15 years now?
14.
Don't
stop pushing.
Not quite that long.
Okay,
I was born
years.
In the 60s.
It's kind of like being this exclusive club. And, you know, I knew these guys would, and, you know, Michael was still a teenager when we met.
And this exclusive club is at a creative peak. R.E.M.'s newest release, Monster, which many say is their boldest and best album yet, debuted at number one on the Billboard charts.
Compared to the last two records, there's so few elements actually going on in each song that everyone had kind of like really definite ideas about what each of those elements should do, and we didn't often agree. So,
we're on the same team, but we're not always on the same page.
But what was it about this album, Michael, that really put a lot of strain on you?
Finishing.
To make this one.
Yeah.
L.A.
Mixing that.
The first single that was released from the album got an awful lot of attention. What's the Frequency, Kenneth? Is obviously not music to Dan Rather's ears. Why that title?
I think Dan Rather actually likes it.
The title refers to the anchorman's unfortunate experience with a mugger. But the group says the song is not about Rather and was not meant to be disrespectful.
Kind of, you know, I'd like to go up and just say, shake his hand and say, Dan, nothing personal.
Rather aside, the album has special meaning for the group. And for Stipe, it was an emotional one to make. Now, the album is actually dedicated to someone who was a very close friend of yours, the late River Phoenix.
River died a month into the making of the record, and he was with me throughout the whole thing. I found it very difficult to write because I was feeling a great deal of sadness.
And you also wrote a song on this album for Kurt Cobain.
Yeah, it was very much a part of, you know, what made this record what it is.
Starting in January, you will begin another world tour, and it's going to be your first one in over 5 years. Do you have any apprehensions about going on the road again?
I was afraid I might break a hip, you know, but...
Osteoporosis.
I think all of us kind of realize, you know, that we're probably never going to be in a position like this again. We're probably never going to be as popular and able to do a world tour on this scale, and I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to have a ball.
Now, when R.E.M. kicks off their world tour in January, their first stop will be Australia.